Hello and welcome to the second day of the Blender Conference 2006 in Amsterdam. We're here again and the place is crowded. There are even more people than yesterday and it really shows that it has been sold out this year. I've seen people from all over the world, people from Japan, Australia, South America, for example, the Plumiferous people, North America, Europe, you name it, the entire world is here and we're trying to talk to as many people as we can, giving you some nice interviews and a bit of an impression of what went on here today. So, let's go see what happened today.
De gekke stukjes er al af.
Zijn we er goed op?
Ja.
Ietsje hoger zetten misschien.
Ja,
maar het gaat vooral om jou. Je kan altijd een beetje. Ja, dit is goed.
Ja.
Oké.
Okay.
Ja, kom maar langs. No problem. No problem. Ja. Okay, I would like to introduce to you, I don't know your achternaam,
Vruchten?
Vruchts Verstappen.
Yeah.
Okay, good. I would like to introduce to you Anja Vruchts Verstappen, and you may not know her by name, but you will know her by reputation. Anja has been the steady force behind the Blender financials and the eShops for years now, and she's been helping on the Blender conference as well. So, Anja, for how long have you been involved with Blender?
Oh, that's very long. I'm involved with Tom 18 years now.
18 years?
18 years, yeah. And almost 1.5 years with Not a Number, I was not there, but all the other time I had doing the bookkeeping for Tom and later on also the eShop.
So you were there from the very first time that Tom started with Blender?
Yeah, he was just starting 1.5 years with Frank van Beek together with Neo Geo, and then I they asked me to come to keep the bookkeeping, so of that moment I see growing everything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. And what is the kind of work that you do now for Tom?
Most of the work is the eShop. So I do all the orders in the shop, and when they have paying, packing in everything, and I send it up to everyone. So and also as they have problem that they cannot make the payment, so I answer all the emails. And something like that. And
so if you get an email from the eShop,
This
is the lady that does it.
Yeah, I said only my name, first name on in the answer, not the rest of my name. So, but yeah, that's I have to do that all the time already. So that's easy.
Now, I did the eShop for Not a Number for a few years as well, and I know how much work it is to back everything and send it, and I also know that you have a lot of books and CDs and everything. How do you work? Do you work from home or?
Yeah, I work from home, and I have one room for my office, and we have a little room where we have all the storage for the books, and because as they're coming 300 books, you must need space to put it, and or more books, but we have now already sold from the 2.3 guide almost 2,500 books, so that we have sold also. No Star Press have also sold very much books, so I think it is a good book.
And so you have one room filled with Blender articles.
Now on this moment it is almost empty because we must decide if we print the book again or wait till the new book is there. And also we have sell almost all DVDs. And I have only 250 left in the stock now. So we have sell 2,600 DVDs. So that's a big
impressive.
That's very impressive. Yeah,
I think that's more than what you needed, right?
Yeah. Also, but we have now the selling us now for the next project Tom wants to do. So he wants to do a new film project. So I think it is a good thing that we have it as people buy the DVD, that it is a donation for the next project already. So
Okay, and you've also been here for 5 years at the conference, I think.
4 years. The first year was Frank doing the registration and the sandwiches, but after that I and my wife Anne had doing that. So,
okay.
And we do that, I think, every year better.
How do you compare the years? Is it getting better? Or are they getting
it is better, and also, but it is also more people here, so we must every year make more sandwiches, and that's so.
Well, I think it was very nice to talk to you.
Thank you.
Think everyone will be delighted to see the face behind Blender. Also.
Yeah, thank you.
So thank you, Anya.
Anna. Okay.
Hi, I'm here with Sascha Goedegebeuren, also known as Sago, on the Blender Artist Forums. And I'm interviewing him because it was demanded on the website that I do so. And I believe you have a bit of a story to tell about how that came to be, right?
The story, yeah, the story is about a man. He calls himself Woo-Man. Woo-Man, that's like Woo-Man, but it's not important. So we'll just skip that when we go to the next question. Thank you.
Yeah, well, Sascha, you've been one of my favorite artists on the forums, in fact.
Oh, thank you.
And I really enjoy your work. I remember the "Don't push the red button."
And oh yeah, that's an oldie. That's
the Braveless Night.
Yeah. Braveless Night was actually one of my first. It was when I used Jeffray.
Uh-huh.
When I started blendering, I started right away with Jeffray because I didn't have to worry about lightning and materials. I just put a lamp in and it was done. So, but the internal render, this I learned in the last year, and it's getting better and better and better. Just you have to keep on going. So
okay, so you only use the internal renderer for your work now, or
yes, from now on, yes.
And how did you find Blender? How did you start working with it?
Someone just mentioned it. That's it. I never heard it, never seen it. So. Coincidence, that's all.
And was it horrible to learn, or
it was a real pain. Yeah, it was terrible, but I'm a slow learner, especially when it comes to technical stuff. And yeah, Blender can be extremely technical at points, but yeah, just keep on trying, keep on doing things, keep on experimenting. So yeah, it will work out sometimes.
Now, this year you've made the switch to animation as well, whereas before you only did stills.
Mm-hmm.
How did that happen, and what did you learn while doing that?
Well, I wanted to do animation for a real long time ago, but it was the same as before, trial and error, and nothing really worked. And yeah, this was the first, my animation Man in Man, it was the first one that actually I could finish, because I started thousands of animations, but I could never finish it because it was too complex, too difficult. But yeah, this time I thought, keep it easy, just one character, not too much movement, and everything works out just fine. Just step by step, baby steps at a time.
How do you think of such a movie? When I saw it the first time, it had this horrible but also humoristic feel to it. And you can't help but smile, and at the same time you have pain in your stomach watching it. How did you think of that?
I don't know, actually. The idea of coming, a hand coming out of a guy, no, I really don't know. I even don't know if I think it's funny anymore, because I've worked all those months I worked on it, and you don't know whether something is funny or looks good. So, but no, I don't know where the idea comes from.
Well, it was playing last night on the movie festival, mm-hmm. and everybody was really enthusiastic about
it. Oh, that's
it.
Great.
So we had a big applause at the end of it.
Yeah. So, yeah. I wanted to see it live on the internet, but we all know that didn't work, so such a shame. Anyway, so it went okay.
It went well, yeah.
Oh, so. And you didn't see my other animation.
No, not yet. So we're going to take care of that in a few minutes.
Okay. Yeah. It's, by the way, it's the Ton Roosendaal versus the evil sea creature. Be sure to check it out. Thank you.
Cool. Okay, last question. I ask everyone this one question. What does Blender mean for you personally?
It's a hobby that... Yeah, it will be a hobby forever, I'm sure. And perhaps maybe in the future I can do some paying jobs with it. But that's not what I really want. I just want it to stay, keep it as a hobby. And that's the most important thing. And hopefully I can keep entertaining people. And that's all that matters for me. So
well, I think you're doing that very well. So thank you. It was good to talk to you.
Thanks.
I'm sitting here in the back room where all the video editing is being done by Philippe Lepalan. I hope I'm pronouncing that right.
Yeah, that was really good.
And if you've been watching our streams or our downloads, this is the guy who has been editing it all together, making sure you see either the audience or the presenter or the computer stream. So I'm curious to hear about what's going on here these days and about Philippe's work. So Philippe, how did you get to be here and do all this?
Well, I saw the videos from previous years, and I really loved the content. But I thought that maybe it could be done a little bit better. So I just volunteered, and I'm hoping that this will be nice, the output.
It is, yeah. I heard from the people on the internet that the quality is excellent and the sound is very good. So you've made a lot of people happy here. Yeah,
fantastic. That is really nice.
But you are here for 3 days in this room and not in the room where all the people are. How does that feel?
Well, it's even better because I still see everything and I have a very comfortable chair. So it's at least as good. Of course, I don't get to talk to as many people as I'd like to, but it's good. And of course, this is the backstage, so I feel a bit like a rock star now, too.
You're part of the crew, right?
Yeah, that's an awesome feeling.
So how come you know how to operate this kind of equipment?
It's very easy. You just push the button and watch. You have two screens and you just select between them. Anyone could do it. But in video, I have some previous experience. But this one, anyone could do this job, basically.
And what is your what do you use Blender for?
Oh, that's a good question. I really don't use Blender at all. Well, I only for a few projects, but I really like it as a program. I think it's a very interesting software, and of the community is really good, and it's very accessible to anyone who asks to me that I'd like to start doing 3D. I just say, of course, take Blender because it's available, and there's so much material to learn, so it's really nice. So I'm just like a fanboy of this whole world.
A fanboy who flew all the way from Estonia to help us here to prepare the video feed, right?
Yeah.
Well, I think we can be very happy that you decided to help us here, and I'm sure people will like to see that you, who you are and what you've been doing here. Yeah. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Center geometry to center through space, center manipulator, grid tags, triangulate, find all the plots.
Hi, I'm here with Andy. I'm going to ask him some questions. Hopefully, he will be able to answer them. Hello, Andy.
Hello.
We were wondering. You went to Argentina to meet the Plumiferous project team. I wonder if you could talk a bit about it.
Oh well. What should I say about it? I mean, those people are really, really. I don't know. They have so much work to do, and it's amazing how they handle it and how professional they are. And I mean, they're just a bunch of people, like basically about 25 people in a room with computers, doing absolutely amazing stuff, like they've done research for their project for years, and they've been doing concept art folders, sheets of paper, absolutely everything. It's just mind-boggling to see how much work has gone into this so far. So, well, they still have to do a lot. They actually have to finish a movie by, what is it, next year or so? And, well, they still have a lot of things to do. But yeah, it's definitely amazing. Yeah.
And how about your stay there? I know you were there with Bassam. Could you talk a bit, just like, how it was being in Argentina, since it's pretty different from the other places, like here in Amsterdam or wherever you live?
Well, it's not so different. I mean, well, it's in the southern hemisphere of the world. You don't really... It's pretty ordinary, actually. Well, people do eat a lot of meat, and they speak a really weird Spanish accent. Sorry for that, but... I mean, it's, Bassam and I, we lived in Buenos Aires for about, I guess that was about 4 weeks or 3 to 4 weeks together in one apartment. And, I mean, Bassam is a great guy. It's really entertaining to live with him, like, joke all the time or blend or whatever, and go to work with and just have fun. I mean, yeah, we had a lot of fun in Argentina.
One more thing. Could you talk about your projects right now, besides the Plumiferous that you went there? And could you tell us a bit about some projects or personal things you might be doing?
Well, right now I just started to study media arts about last week or so. So I don't know what to expect there, and I have a couple of projects right now. Like I'm planning to finish a short movie by Sigraf next year. That's about March, right? The deadline is March, yeah. And well, hopefully I can finish that. Of course, I'm always doing still images whenever I get the inspiration, or not do anything when I don't have the inspiration. I can't really control it, so yeah. I don't know. Yeah, it could happen any minute that I make an image or something. I don't know.
Just one more thing. We try to ask this to as most people as possible, which is, what is Blender to you?
Blender to me is... Blender to me is... Blender to me is a lifestyle. Blender is a tool to get the job done. Blender is also a way of living. Blender is everything.
Thank you, Andy, and thank you for your time. We'll try to interview more people. Okay, bye.
There are theory implementations, but it's not open tools. That means it's not available, for example, for all devices. And so I'm working in making Blender Pocket run with it. I will not go now into details here, but I can answer questions here. And new ideas are for Newport, for example, all Linux, and you could make probably some fantastic things with Blender. So the other priority is to promote Blender and Blender Pocket, writing some tutorials, because you are four kinds of users. So,
I'm talking to Sander Witt now, and Sander is the creator of one of my favorite Blender images called Up and Down by the Dutch artist M.C. Escher. I've always been wondering how Sander pulled it off in Blender, and today is my chance to find out. So, Sander, can you tell a little bit about how you created this work?
Yes, I hope I can. First, I want to make sure that you understand how the image is, what it is that you see, because most people think it are actually two renders, one from the lower half and one from the top half, but it is actually one rendered in one time. It is, you could say it is a vertical panorama, but it is rendered as lying down, because Blender doesn't have a vertical panorama function as far as I know. So it was just rendered, it was rendered horizontal and then rotated to like so. I'll open the 3D version so you'll be able to see the scene. These white lines is my my big camera. What the camera does is it rotates like so. If I'm going into the camera, you'll see the scene as it, the way it is constructed. I'll explain how it is done later on. And what the camera does, it rotates around the, let's say, the z-axis of the camera, so not anything in the world. It rotates like so. So horizontally it rotates. And it makes 64 small slices and stitches it together with the panorama function in Blender. So here are the slices, 64, and the panorama function is turned on. You can see the X resolution is pretty high, 2500 pixels, and the Y resolution is 1000 pixels high. So it actually renders a panorama the way you see it right now. So this is how it is rendered. So it's rendered in one shot, you can say, but 64 slices. Well, here's the scene from as it is. I'll open the image. This is the lower half of the scene. You see the staircase from below. And if you rotate further up, you'll see that you are looking actually from above. So that's probably I get a class. That's cool. I haven't. So here's the staircase from the top, and if you rotate down the way the camera does more smoothly, you see you are actually at the bottom. So you probably know this is. I'll show the horizon. It makes more sense. This is our horizon, the way you see it in the picture. I'll make my window a bit smaller. You can see in the horizon an image of the background. You can see it in the back, the way it should. And if you look above, you can see the same background, but from a higher position scene. This is not the same scene. It is actually a duplication of it, as you can see here. I'll turn off the grid so you'll see it better.
While the camera is upside down, you have a duplicate of the horizon, which is also upside down.
Exactly. Yes, precisely. So this is my everything you see in front of the camera, and the background is just this white space in the background. So. The way I did it isn't the most smart way. I just today found out it was a lot easier if I constructed the world like so, because the world is now duplicated. If I show you from the side, I'll split this screen. Oh, here you can see the scene is duplicated around the X axle, like so. So this is actually a duplication of the original scene. I used to have the scene rotated like so. Why? I don't really know. I think it was just more handy to make the staircase and stuff. So it's kind of inconvenient from me, but well, anyway. So that's about the background.
You learned about the new way here today by talking to other Blender users.
Sure. Yeah, I was trying to explain this object in to another person, and I found out, hey, why didn't I rotate the complete scene 45 degrees around the Z axle? Yeah, good point. So that's something I could have done smoother, but well, I pulled it up anyway, so that's not a big problem. So then I started modeling with this staircase and well, this building, and the building actually stops with this wall. This wall doesn't exist. It's like this is the duplication of this wall. This door you see here is this door upside down. You can see it in this picture too. The door is invisible. Oh, it's here. Here's the door, and it's upside down right here. So it's the same door, but duplicated around the and rotated around the axle. Well, yeah. How do you explain how I created it? It's the main things that help me to find out where I should make what is the tiles. The tiles on the floor is probably the best thing about the original work, because with the tiles you can actually see how far the, for example, the staircase is from the wall. It's just the biggest help I had is the tiles on the floor. Then you can make everything the same size. I think how I created it, it's not like I have made the bottom one and duplicated around the camera and done. No, I had to. It was trial and error because the walls didn't stitch together the way they should, and walls were going through each other the way you expected it to be. So it was really trial and error at the beginning. But when I got the tiles correctly, the tiles are just square, so you can see where the pole should be. It's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. The 10th tile, there starts the pole. Same thing here. So that helped me a lot with duplicating the scene. So, yeah, I think that's the main...
So you were able to model the entire scene by looking at the grid on the floor of Escher's original work?
Yes.
Or at least the flat layout, I
yes,
guess.
Well, then I... Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. It isn't like... it doesn't tell me everything, just the floor, but it helped a hell of a lot with determining where my roof should be, for example. Because the floor is, in fact, the roof. And the roof, if you rotate further, is the floor. So, yeah.
Well, I think it's a very clever thing that you've done here. And I'm glad I can see how you've done it now, because I couldn't figure it out.
Okay, well, I hope it's more clear now.
And there's a little something I want to show you. I just realized it today, that I've been using your image on my phone for over a year now, ever since you first made it.
That's so cool.
It's always been here. So, yeah.
Funny.
Everyone I show this to loves it. So. Excellent.
Wow. Yeah. Well, in fact, Blender of Escher made it in, I thought it was in 67 or something in Holland. And he made something really fabulous. And in original work, there is a girl in this window and a boy sitting on the stairs. And they're looking at each other. So that's one thing I made it about a year ago. So I wasn't able to create anatomy of persons or stuff, so I kept it at architecture. So in original, there is the original by Escher. There's a girl in the window and a boy on the staircase. So you see the boy from here. You can see the boy's point of view towards the girl, and in the upper half of the picture, you see.
That's why it's called up and down.
Yes.
Because one is looking up and the other is looking down.
Yes. You can, from here you see what the girl sees at the boy, and from here you see the boy, what he sees is the girl. So that's one thing that I haven't included in the scene, what I probably should have. But well, hey.
Well, I don't think it's really missing. So.
No, thanks.
Okay. Well, thank you for explaining, Sander. I'm sure everyone will enjoy this very much. Thank
okay,
you.
Thanks.
Okay, that's it for now. we are going to enjoy the Suzanne Awards, and then we're going to the restaurant. There'll be more news for you on this website tomorrow. Bye. Have fun.